Yeah. Let's do it. Hi everyone, this is Purnima Jha from Clay Prep Schools in Daycare. I'm a regional curriculum manager at Clay and have been in the field of education for more than a decade. And today we are going to discuss about one of my favorite topics, which is building emotional intelligence in children. I think we all will agree that in the current scenario, in the situation when we see there are so many obstacles we are finding, there are so many restrictions we are finding, there one important thing that plays a very important role is our emotions. How do we manage, take care of our emotions and our children's emotions? So today we are going to discuss about this topic. Our webinars are one of the initiatives that Clay has taken as a parent partnership program. The reason being that the parents are very important when it comes to discussing about the learning and development of the child. Without you, we can't ensure that, you know, the children will get the best. So welcome again for the emotional intelligence webinar that we are going to have. If you have any query, anything that you would like to discuss, you can write your question on the chat. At the end of the session, I will be discussing about all these questions. And I will also share a mail ID that you can always mail it to us, which is for a parent helpline. So let's start the webinar and I will start my PPT, okay? Thank you. So when we are talking about emotional intelligence, it's important to understand what exactly we mean by that. So let's go through the PPT and see what's here in the store. You know, we are talking about emotions of our children. So I think one thing that they love is music, songs, and dance. So we'll start our session with a rhyme. Before that, I would like to tell you what am I going to cover in this session. Like I said, first we'll try to understand what exactly we mean by emotional intelligence. What is the benefit? Like why we are spending time and why should we actually know about the emotional intelligence as a parent and an educator? Then we are going to talk about how brain controls the emotional intelligence and what is our role as a parent and primary caregiver for our children. We are also going to talk about more about emotional intelligence in the early childhood and how to develop. If we understand that it's very beneficial and it's important for our children, then naturally we have to also find the ways on how to develop it. So let's start. Have you heard this rhyme? This is one of the favorite rhyme that our children like. And this is if you are happy and you know it. I would like you to focus and hear this song and just think about what is the message that you get from this rhyme. Okay, so I'm sure you would have heard it lots of time because this is one of the favorite rhyme that our children love. I wanted you to see the words that I have highlighted. We are talking about that if you are happy, what you should do. First thing is you should know it. Then we are saying, oh, you know that you are happy, then you should show it and clap your hands. So if I generalize it and try to understand, the meaning is that if you have an emotions, if you're feeling something, first step is to know it, that you should identify what am I feeling. Not only children, even as an adult, there are several times when we have found we are not able to actually understand and identify what exactly we are feeling. Now, when we have understood that, okay, this is my feeling, I know what I feel, this is my emotion, what should I do? I should show it. This means I should know how to express it. And how will I express? There will be different ways. So here I'm talking about, we are saying, okay, clap your hands, say hooray, and the children become very excited. The whole idea is that you have an emotion You should identify, you should express it, and there has to be a way in which you let others also know that this is how you are feeling, right? It's not only about happiness. We should also know, if I'm angry, what should I do? If I'm very sad, what should I do, right? So when we're talking about the emotional intelligence, the very first thing that you should know, identify your emotion, express it in an appropriate way, right? So now, why am I highlighting so much on expressing? Why should we express our emotion? Okay, so here is, why should we express our feelings? What happens when we express our feelings? Do we feel more connected? We feel more empowered and understood? Sometimes it's just relieved, you know. You go and talk to other, and it's not that you are always looking for a solution. Sometimes we just want to be heard. Oh, you heard me and I am feeling better. But there are times when we don't express, we don't communicate to others that this is how I am feeling. I am getting hurt, but I am not expressing. I am angry, but I am not expressing. What happens? It keeps building up. I can see someone asking, Dhananjay is asking, I'm not able to ask questions. Dhananjay, you can just write in the chat box. I will get back to the answer at the last of the session. Yeah, thank you. So what happens when we don't express our feelings? It keeps building up and it gets worse. Sometimes you would have heard that, you know, we don't tell anyone that if we are not sharing with someone that we are not liking their habit or the way they are expressing. Keeps building up like a pressure cooker, and sometimes it's like just it come out and then we are not able to express it properly. Urmila, are you able to hear me properly now? So what happens when we don't express it? Build up, sometimes it gets worse and it increases our stress. So you know, for a healthy relationship, it's not going to help anyone. Sometimes we don't express, thinking that, okay, I'm not telling this person, so I'm not hurting my relationship. But that's not true. Because today you are not talking about it, tomorrow you will not talk about it, but the day it will come out, it will be more toxic. So why not to build a healthy relationship? Why not to express it so that we also feel connected and empowered and make others also feel how we are feeling, right? So we'll talk about it. Here is the next slide. We are talking about emotional intelligence, right? We started with the fact that, you know, when we have an emotion, we should be able to identify, we should be able to express, we should be able to let others know that this is what I'm feeling. So emotional intelligence, if we go by the definition, it's like awareness and understanding of emotions. Here, I understand my emotion, and not only mine, I should be able to understand emotion of others in a better way. Okay, because it's not about understanding your own emotion. We are a social people and we need to connect with others. How will I connect with others? Because if I understand how they are feeling, then I will be able to use my verbal and non-verbal communication in such a way that I'm able to connect to them. Yeah. So if you are able to do all this, that is, you are aware of your own emotions, you know how to express it and manage it appropriately. At the same time, you understand emotions of others. This means you have actually got emotional intelligence. So let's go forward and see what's happening. So this is what one of the research by Mayer and Salovey says, that emotional intelligence has a positive role. Sensitivity for others and one's own emotion. You are sensitive towards your emotion and others' emotion. Never underestimate the fact that you have to take care of yourself, right? We always talk about, first you take care of yourself, then only you will be able to take care of others. Coping with stress. We all are living in a situation when there are lots of time, there are lots of stresses that we are finding. How do we cope with the stress that we are finding and not, you know, transmit it to others? The thing that we should be doing is we should be able to cope with our emotion and we should be able to bring more positivity in our life. And in the situation that we are living in, it's really required. Maintaining positive mood and openness. If we have not pent up our emotions in a negative way, we will be able to maintain the positivity. And that positivity is going to help us being open, being having a better quality of the leadership and overall life satisfaction. So we have discussed till now that we are talking about the emotions. When it comes to the emotions, we should be able to identify emotion. We should be able to express it appropriately. And it's not only about our emotion. We have to understand others' emotion and empathize with them. And how it helps, like here we have discussed that it really plays a big role in overall our life satisfaction. Because you will be happy, you will maintain that positive mood, and you are spreading that happiness. What else to ask for, right? So now, when we are talking about the emotions, my question to you is, think about which part of the body controls the emotions. You know, if you go and hear all the songs, they all are talking about the heart, emotions, feelings. Are you aware that it's our brain who is going to control the emotion? Yes. And while we are talking about the brain development, is not going in the detail about the technical aspect, but to understand how the brain development is happening in the early childhood, and how as a parent and educator you are going to influence. So early childhood is a time of tremendous brain development. I'm sure there are lots of ads that keep coming and saying, you know, first 5 year of your child's life, the brain is developing. It's very important, very critical, do X, Y, Z, right? So what happens is when a baby is born, it's born with billions of neurons that they will ever need in their lifetime. But it is a connection between the brain cells, the neurons, that really makes the brain work. How will that connection come? The connections in the brain are developed through their everyday experiences. So when we're talking about the brain, there are different areas of the brain that are responsible for different abilities. Here, because we are talking about the emotional development, the limbic system of the brain is the one which will be controlling our basic emotions. In the limbic system also, specifically if I have to tell, it's the amygdala and the prefrontal cortex which will be doing it, right? So as I have shown here, that amygdala is the trigger point for emotions, and the prefrontal cortex will be playing a very important role in emotion regulation. The arrows that I have shown is just to symbolically tell that they are interconnected. So the stimulus, the information that they are getting from the environment is going to be exchanged, and that way your child's synaptic connections are going to be built. Now the question is, if this is the development happening in the brain, what can we do, right? So now let's see what we can do. When we're talking about the limbic system and we are saying it's the brain which is going to take care of the emotional development, there are different research which says that the bonding with the primary caregiver and the connections with the environment is going to play a very critical role in your child's life. This means, parents, that everything you do with your child, that every connection that you do, everything, all the conversation that you are going to do, it's going to have an impact in your child's brain. So if your role is so critical, then you can understand that every interaction that you are having with your child, shouldn't it be very conscious that am I helping my child in building a positive emotional intelligence? So I have just given a reference of working paper from National Scientific Council on Developing Child from Harvard University. I like the title itself, which says the children's emotional development is built into the architecture of their brains. So the emotional development is going to play a very important role. And don't forget that that whole thing will actually be influenced by everything that you do with your child. The environment that you create, the conversation that you have with your child, the love, the warmth, the feeling of security that you are giving to your child is going to influence that, right? So now, we are talking about parents playing a very important role in a child's life, in a child's emotional intelligence. This also means that we have to see what as a parent we can do, right? There will be something which you can control as a parent. There will be things which we can't control. So if there are few things that we can do and it will really help in our emotional intelligence of our children, why not to know about it? So I'm having a separate slide for infants, because as an infant parent, you will realize that, you know, a child is not able to express verbally. I will not say the child is not expressive, because there are lots of non-verbal communication that your child is doing with you. The conversation mode is, of course, through the cries that they're having, the facial expression and the body movement, right? You go near your child and the expression that show actually tells you, my child is happy, my child is sad, my child wants me to take them out, right? So what you can do is, there are very simple things which have big impact. Talking to your child, reading, singing together. It helps your child feel special and loved. Oh, someone is there. I am getting the personal attention. Have you seen? You just, when you are not in front of child, the child actually shows restlessness, because they are able to understand, oh, my mom is not here. Where is my dada? And they are looking for you. They want your personal attention. They want the love and the warmth from you. So now what else we can do? We can have a warm and consistent smile, laugh and cuddle. Because though we might feel that we are angry, we are upset, but I'm not telling it to my child. I'm just fighting with my husband. It's not true. Our children, they are able to get the vibes that parents are passing. So if the smile is not genuine, if you are not really happy, you will see that the child is able to understand. You have to maintain consistent and predictable routine. You know what happens? The routine you will set, right? So you will, your child will be having a nap time, your child will be having the food time and they will eat. These simple routines help a child feel safe and secure. For example, at Clay also, when we have infants coming with us, we always maintain their routine, their timetable, because it's very important to understand and respect the timetable, the body clock of an infant. It will help your child feel more safe and secure. Be an emotional role model. Easier said than done. Okay, so there's a term called as social referencing. What they say is that, you know, a very young child, how do they learn? They learn different aspects by watching you. It's not what you say, it's everything that you do, the child is watching. I'll give you a very simple example. You know, there is a rod on which a curtain is there. And the child is going towards it and the mother is scared that, you know, the curtain might fall and the child might get hurt. Even if the mother is not saying anything, but the expression of the mother is showing that there is something wrong in it. The shock expression or maybe the fear expression, you will find the child will stop. Not because the mother has told anything, but the child also get the you from your face, that, oh, something is wrong. I'm sure there will be parents who will be thinking, but it goes other way for my child. Whatever I say, don't do it, they do it, right? See, the child is learning a lot from their environment. That's why we say that the primitive year, the early years of the child, there are lots of sensory learning happening. So when we say that don't do it and they are trying to do it, that is also the way of learning. But it doesn't mean that they are not learning from you. You would have seen your child imitating the way you talk or walk, or sometimes the tone of the language. Because they are listening to us, they are watching us, and they are learning by doing it. And say what you think an infant is feeling. Don't go by this assumption that the child is very young, they will not understand. Like I said, they will understand the language of emotion. Not only about being a verbally expressive, it can be your body language, the way you are expressing your child. Just make your child feel special. Yeah. So now we will also discuss about more ways in which you can do the verbally express it to your child. So first thing first, listen to your child. I'm sure you might be thinking, what's big in it here? I always keep listening to my child. But when I'm talking about listening, it's not only any listening. I'm talking about actively listening to your child. Give your complete attention. You have a mobile in your hand. You have a remote in your hand. Please keep everything aside. The child might be coming with a very simple thing and you will like, what is this? What's a big deal in it? It's very big for a child. The child has made a block and coming to tell you this is a giraffe. Please appreciate that. Because your child is actually able to visualize and the child wants to be appreciated. Wants the parent to acknowledge, right? So stop other things that you are doing and repeat and reflect. So what happens is if I have to make my child understand that, hey, I'm listening to you, how will I express it? So first thing, make eye contact with your child. So be in the same level that your child is and repeat that sentence. Oh, so for example, here I mentioned, I see that you're sad because your friend snatched your toy. Am I right? So I'm repeating whatever the toy child would have said. Papa, mera toy kisi ne chheen liya, my child, my friend has snatched my toy. So what I'm acknowledging and saying, hey, you are sad, I understand. Now, if I listen to my child, what should be the second step? The second step is acknowledging and validating their feelings. Don't make me feel that my feelings are not important. If I'm coming to you saying that I'm upset, I'm angry that my younger brother has snatched my toy or my elder brother is not playing with me, it's a big deal for me, right? So you have to first validate, at least acknowledge my feeling. So now what will you say? Oh, I know you are not happy that we are not going to park. I too feel sad when I'm not able to, right? So now in the current scenario, when you are at home, there will be time when your child wants to say that, hey, I want to go out, please take me, right? So we can't take them out. We have to make them understand that this is not possible. But that it has to start with the fact that I acknowledge, I understand that your feelings are genuine. Even I feel sad. One of the big problems that we face is that there are lots of times parents don't express their emotion, right? There are times when we are talking to our child and asking, hey, are you happy? What happened? You're sad? Why are you angry? But just think and reflect, how many times are we going and talking to a child and saying that, I'm very sad. I am getting so angry that this is not happening. Are we expressing our emotion? How will the child understand that this is the way to express my emotion? So when you are acknowledging your feeling, their feelings, when you are validating their feeling, also make them that feel that, yeah, I too feel this. What happens when we are soothing our child, the neural pathway, we were talking about the synaptic connections, right? That the amygdala is there, cortex is there, there are new connections being built. How is it being built? All the experiences that the child is getting through you, it is going to help the child. It is going to teach a child how to self-soothe. It's going to help the child in their coping mechanism. So simple ways by which you accept their emotions help your child, help their child express and accept their emotions also. Yeah? So we have discussed the first thing. You are going to listen actively to them, maintaining the eye level, listening to them by reflecting and repeating what they are saying. Second, we are also acknowledging, we are validating their feeling. We will not say that why you are angry. Let's first understand and say, hey, I understand your toy is broken, that you are upset. But then continue and say what to do next, right? Now, next, what you can do is, when we were talking about the whole webinar thing, that when we started with a lovely song. If you're happy and you know, clap your hand, right? And we say, it's very important for us to teach a child how to identify and label the emotion. You know, identifying and labeling, when we start, there will be, the child is very young, they will understand some basic emotion. They will understand happy, they will understand sad, angry. And as they grow up, their emotional vocabulary also increases. So if you are able to help your child identify what happens, the child also understands, okay, this is what my feeling, and then how should I express it, right? So when my step number one is done, I'm able to identify this is what I am feeling. I will figure out how to express it. But if I'm not knowing, I'm not aware, I'm not able to put it in the words that, hey, this is my feeling, it is going to impact me, right? You would have heard that toddlers doing tantrums. Why are they doing it? They are not doing it for fun. If they are not able to express that this is what I am feeling, I am angry that you have done this to me. You are not taking me to park. I wanted to buy this toy and you are not giving me. I am upset. And I am doing tantrum, right? If we help our child build up the emotional vocabulary, identify their emotions, they will be able to express it verbally. So the first step we are saying, the child should be able to identify and label the emotions. And that will come when you start expressing, when you are talking to your child. Hey, are you upset that you cannot go out to play? Looks like you're very angry right now. Do you want to speak about it? We are going to zoo today. Are you feeling excited? The emotions, there are lots of things that are related, right? The body language, the way we are expressing, the tone, everything. How will the child understand that this is the way we express it? You parent, you are the one who is going to make that most impact. So start using emotion words in your sentence. Okay? There are different ways in which we can do here. I have just given example that you can actually make a lovely mood meter. Basically, the name itself says, it is going to tell you how is the mood. So for example, you are making 2-3 smileys and you are keeping that this is happy, this is sad, angry, surprised, right? And every day ask your child, okay, come on, come on, come on, mama will tell you this. I'm feeling very sad. I can't go out. How are you feeling? Mama, I am feeling happy because you have given me this toy to play. Oh, lovely, right? So you can make mood meter, or there are different ways. The whole idea is, if you understand the objective is that I should know from my child that how are they feeling, what is the emotion they are going through, right? That can be expressed through different ways. At Clay, what we do is, when our children are there and we do circle time, we ask them to show, hey, are you feeling happy? And you would see them showing their smile and saying, hey, I am happy today. It's about their emotion and asking them, hey, how are you feeling? So it should become a part of routine, right? You go and ask your child, are you hungry? You want to eat something? Shouldn't we go and ask, hey, how are you feeling? So first, we have listened to our children. Then we are validating and acknowledging that I understand. Your mom understands what you are feeling. Now we are helping our child to identify and label the emotion that, mama, this is what I am feeling. Now, next is the emotional vocabulary, right? The slide before this one, we discussed about labeling the emotion, right? Happy, sad, angry, these were the words. How do we help them build the emotional vocabulary and build a fluency, right? You know, if you are talking to anyone, just listen to their conversation. Person might be very fluent and you will feel that, oh, nice, how effectively they are able to communicate, right? But the effective communication is not only because you are able to use the words very fluently. You will also have to see, is that person having a good fluency when it comes to the emotional vocabulary? Are we talking about the feeling? Are we talking about the emotions? So there are simple steps which I have mentioned, like use action word. I feel, I love to, I'm excited to do this. I am worried. What are you doing? You are actually helping your child build that emotion vocabulary. Okay, I feel this, but why do I feel it, right? I am angry, this is not complete. The second step will be, okay, I am feeling this because, right? So you have to help your child understand the event or the situation or the actions linked to your feeling. Sometimes we might find and think that he's very young, how will he understand? I'm giving a very basic example. My child was only 3 year old then, and I came back from office very early and I said, "Yeah, I'm so happy to see you." He said, "Mama, why did you come early today?" And I said, "You know what? Because I was missing you." I thought, you know, 3 year old child will understand mama is missing and I'm making a big deal that I care for you so much. And the question he asked me was, "Don't you miss me other days?" It was really surprising for me that a 3 year old child can actually build that connection that you are saying, I came early. This was the action because I was missing you. This was my emotion. But was that emotion missing on the other days? So here I'm focusing and trying to highlight that don't consider that my child is very young. Yes, there will be terms, there will be sentences that you will say that my child will not understand. But I'm sure the child is going to understand your emotions. So use the emotion words in your vocabulary. For example, I'm saying, I feel happy when I. So it can be your game, you know, sometime when we play and we are indoor and we want to do something. You can make some chits with the emoticons, happy, smile, happy, sad, angry, and take out the chit. Okay, this is sad. And now I have to say, I feel sad. Okay, I feel sad when I can't go out. And ask your child, when do you feel sad? Right? So you are helping a child understand. First, we have started with understanding the identifying the emotion. Labeling the emotion. Now we are talking about the vocabulary and building the fluency. To build that fluency, we will use more of the action word. And it's not only about the action, you have to also explain the event and the reason behind it. You might think that the child is young, but believe me, your child is understanding everything, so you can go ahead. Okay. Next is about emotion stories. I have listed down few stories here, but this is just to give you few examples. The whole idea is to understand that the story time, it is really critical. I'm sure most of you must be having a bedtime story with your child. Please ensure that in a day, at least once, for some time, you have a story time with your child. We know that stories help in lots of dimensions, right? Stories help a child build the imagination. Stories build a child their vocabulary and all. But teaching a child emotion through a story is also very effective. So I'm not asking you that you go and buy these storybooks to teach emotions, because emotions can be taught anywhere. Goldilocks left the parents' house and the Goldilocks is in the bear's house. What do you think the Goldilocks is feeling? Goldilocks, when she saw all these three bears, what do you think? Was she happy? Was she scared? Right? So it is in any story that you can use these emotion words and make that story itself more effective. At the same time, teaching the emotional vocabulary to your child. So take any story today, read that story for your child, show the picture. So if you have got a picture book, you will see the expressions that a character is showing. There will be lots of time, even without the text, you can show the picture and say, what do you think Goldilocks is feeling now? See her eyes, how is she feeling, right? So there are different ways in which you can do it. So I'm not trying to stress on the fact that this is the way to do it. Every child is unique and your child will have her own way of understanding. The whole idea is that are there ways in which you are able to use these words in your daily life? It's not a one-time affair. It's not the one time today I'm going to talk about the emotion and my child will become emotionally intelligent, right? There was a research that said that, you know, when we are talking about the development in the early years, there are cognitive development that is happening. Yeah, physical development that is happening, and the side by side at the same time, emotional development is happening. But unfortunately, it is not getting the importance that the other development are getting, right? We are thinking about the cognitive development, doing the puzzles with our children. We are talking lots of things, you know, my child knows color, my child knows shape, size, and not what. Are you also thinking about, is my child able to express the emotion? How is my child feeling today? So let's talk about emotions. Let's use more and more of the emotion words and use the stories to teach the emotions. Now, next is about empathy. You know, empathy is one of the important life skills for a child. Not only for a child, it's for us also, but it's very important that we help a child build empathy. So if I'm talking about building empathy, the child's ability to understand and share the feelings of others. You know, you meet several people in your life. You would have found there are people who understand lots about your emotion without you saying anything at all to them. And then there are people you will go and tell everything, but you don't see them actually understanding it. Where is the difference? The difference is in the emotional intelligence. Are they able to understand and share your feelings? So these are the simple things which I have mentioned here that you can do with your child. When they see an animal or someone is hurt, go and ask, what will you do? Can we help that? If there are birds that they can see, that you can say, oh, the bird is hungry, can we feed that bird? We keep some water, it's summertime, right? You are getting thirsty so often. Think about the pigeons outside. Are they also feeling very thirsty? Can we keep some waters for them, right? So the whole idea here is that we have to help our child build empathy. Our children should be very caring, right? I have seen lots of debates going on saying that, you know, nowadays, children are not empathetic. They don't take care of others. They are only thinking about themselves. Isn't it a moment for us to pause and think, who is teaching that? Have I taught my child by doing and taking care of others? If I am doing that, won't my child see that and understand that this is something we should be doing? For everything, I'm not talking about only emotional development. I'm sure all the webinars that you will understand, you will go through and understand about the emotional development of a child. Parents, you are a role model of your child. They are looking forward and saying, Mama is doing like this, I should be doing like this, right? If my mother is giving respect to my caregiver, I will also give respect. If my mama is taking care of the birds and animals and thinking about others, I am going to learn that. It's not about what you say. It is about what you do. Okay? So we will just recapitulate again the few things and then we'll move to new points. We have started discussing about the emotional intelligence. We understood that emotional intelligence, if I break up all this, the first thing is we should be able to identify. We should be able to express our emotion, and it's not only about our emotion, we should be able to understand others' emotion. Then we also spoke about the benefit of it. We said it's going to impact everything in your life, right? It is going to impact your relationship with others. It's going to impact your mental health. You are not getting stressed out. You are not getting bent up, right? You are able to express your emotions. And then we spoke about that if emotional intelligence is so important, what we can do as a parent. Then we spoke about the brain and we said all the connections that are being built up in the brain, the neural connections in the first 5-6 years of your child is going to play a very critical role. And there, as a parent, you have a power. You have a power to influence that emotional development. because the bonding that they are going to have with you and the connections that they are going to have with the environment is going to be very important for a child. Then we said, okay, then let's figure out how to develop that emotional intelligence. So when we spoke about the infant, we said there are different simple ways to do it with a conscious understanding that whatever we are doing is going to influence my child. Am I gentle enough in my life? Am I able to maintain that calm and composure? Am I able to give the feeling of the safe and security to my child? It's not about what I'm teaching my child. Forget about it. Is my child feeling safe? My mom and dad are there. I'm not worried about anything. There is someone who is taking care of me. She's there with me. My dad is there with me. I'm hungry. Before I'm asking, someone is there to feed me, right? My mama is giving me personal attention. She is singing the song. It's not about the song. The song that you are going to sing for your child, no one can compensate that, right? That the special thing that we feel, even we become nostalgic when we are listening to our parents on phone, because that is a special thing that you as a parent can only give. So talk, read, and sing together. Be consistent. Maintain a predictable routine. And be an emotional role model. Forget about, don't think I have seen sometimes moms thinking, am I a good mother? Am I a good father? Please, you are the best. See from your child's eyes. No one can be better than a father and a mother. My mom is best at any point of time, right? So just make your child feel special, parents. It's not about the strategies or to know. You know better than me, because for your child, you know what works with your child. You will see your child, and without seeing a tear, you will know your child is sad. So it's you who are going to make and bring that change in your child's life. And we spoke about listening to our child, and it's not about you or me. Even I am guilty lots of time. I'm on phone and my child has to actually say, Mama, please listen to me. So it's not about how much time you are giving to your child, but the child needs the quality time. We understand we have lots of work to do. It's not easy to manage your work and the life relationship. For your child, that moment is very precious. So even if you are giving only 10 minutes to your child, let your child feel, this is my time. I'm not going to compromise this, right? So give complete attention to your child. Make the eye contact, repeat and reflect. Then we spoke about validating their feeling. They should feel that you are acknowledging me. It's not about, don't make them feel that, you know, you are angry, you are jealous, and this is negative emotion. No. You are my mom, you are my dad, and you are the first person where I will come and say, hey, this is what I'm feeling. If you are going to say and you are going to make me feel embarrassed that this is wrong, where will I go? So many problems the teenagers are facing are because they are not able to come and say, Mama, I am feeling this. Daddy, I am feeling this, right? If they are able to express their emotion, believe me, half of their problem will be solved. So start validating and empathizing with them. Then you give the reason. I'm not saying that if your child comes and say, I have to go out, and then you take them out, right? Make them understand, but first acknowledge that I understand. I too feel this. Then we spoke about identifying and labeling the emotion. Help your child build more emotion vocabulary. It can be doing through the mood meter, or there are lots of emotion balls, emoticons, balls that are available. You just keep it in a bucket and make it like a feeling game. Okay, come on now. Let's see what I'm feeling. I'll take out this ball. Happy. Okay. Then we spoke about, it's not only about the emotion words. It has to become a fluency, right? You have to develop a fluency, because it has to become a part of your life. It's not a one-time stuff. For that, we spoke about and say, use more of our emotion words. Action words, I feel, I love to, I'm excited, I'm worried. Don't hesitate sharing your feelings with your child. Don't think that my child will not understand. The child understands each and everything. I have seen even the infants. And the mother is crying, and my mother is upset, they stop their crying. because they understand something is wrong. So they are understanding your feeling. Please feel free to use action word. Use more of the words like I love to, I feel, I'm excited. They are going to learn from you. And also reasoning, I feel sad when, I'm happy to do what? So that they will also understand that your emotions are also coming out from something, right? There is some trigger. I am getting angry because there is some trigger. They will be able to understand. You go and tell your child, I get angry when I'm not ready on time. Let your child also reflect when the child gets angry. Oh, I got angry when my toy was thrown by my brother. I understand the trigger of my emotion. Yeah. And like I said, we have to know that being fluent doesn't mean that you have a good emotion vocabulary. So start reflecting just for a fun activity. If you want to do something, write down as many as emotion words that you can write. See how many emotion words you know, and maybe every day go and learn one more emotion word, isn't it? Then we spoke about the emotion stories. It's not about one or two specific stories. Any story can be used as an emotion story. You have to help your child build up the empathy. It's about caring and sharing. If you are doing that, your child will learn about it. So from your environment, the experience that you are giving your child, find out where are the situations where you can actually help your child develop the respect for others, take care of others, and empathize with them. This is something which is going to be very critical. The world needs more empathy parents, and that can come from you. You can build a generation, you can help us build a generation that will be more empathetic, taking care of others. Yeah. Okay, so now till now we spoke about building emotional vocabulary, knowing this is what I'm feeling and expressing it. But is it enough? I feel angry, so what? Right? So I will come and throw my toys because I'm angry. Don't you understand, mom? No, I don't understand. Because it is okay to be angry, but it is not okay to hit your toys, throw your toys, right? Now, the challenge for us is to develop the problem-solving skills for your child. Help your child understand that if there is an emotion, there has to be a way to express it properly. There is no harm in saying that I'm feeling this and expressing it. But what to do what? If I keep getting angry every day, it's not going to help me. I have to find the problem. I have to solve what is the problem that I'm facing. So defining the problem. So for example, the problem can be, I get angry when someone throws my toy. Okay. Now, problem solving skill. This is one of the things that I would like to remember. It's a thumb rule. Please don't help your child in the problem solving unless your child is asking for it. The reason being that you are not helping your child in developing the skill. How will my child actually develop that skill if the child has always an adult who is telling what to do? I'm not talking about the child. As an adult, I remember calling my friends, calling my parents to say, this is what I am facing and please help me. Then they actually stopped helping me, and then I learned that I have to rely on myself. That is what we have to teach, self-reliance, right? So for my emotions, I am feeling these emotions, it's getting pent up. Figure out what to do, okay? My friend, whenever my friend comes and he throws my favorite toy. What will I do? So let the child come up with many ideas, and maybe one of the idea will be, I will keep two baskets. One basket will have toys that I can share with my friends, because it's okay if he's doing this. I am going to talk to my friend, tell him, but my favorite toy, I am going to keep it separately. It is okay. We all are also possessive about our stuff. So if there is something very close to my heart, respect that. Right? So let them first come up with lots of ideas. Don't stick to only, it's not always in the light that one problem, one solution, right? Let them come up with, I can do this, I can do that. Come up with that whole laundry list and then say, okay, in this situation, let's do this. And then implement and evaluate. Work out. I kept two separate baskets, Mama, but still it's not working out. What to do? Again, in the circle, you have reached to define the problem. Okay, maybe let's try and talk to the mother of the child, right? So this circle goes on. Emotion, I identify emotion, I express my emotion, I learn how to solve the problem, and I empathize with other. It's not only always about I, me, myself. It has to be about others. But how will I empathize with others? Because when I respect my emotion, I understand in this situation, my friend is also going through. Can I go and help him? Can I make my friend calm and composed because the favorite toy was thrown? Right? So that empathy is built up. Now, I think this slide doesn't need any explanation. I have been speaking in all the slides, model. You are a role model. Whatever you are doing, your child is going to learn. So if you are using emotion word, I feel angry when I see a dirty room, which is okay because you are telling your child what is making you angry. You don't need to suppress that, but you have to learn how to take it out. I have seen times when the child is angry, child is throwing tantrum, and the parents also get angry on it. So what are you teaching your child? You are teaching your child that it is okay to be angry, right? Because if parents are getting angry, they are shouting at me, they are yelling at me. Why are you coming and stopping me when I'm doing the same thing? So it is okay to express to your child that, you know, I don't like seeing these dirty rooms. Can we do it together? Let's clean up the room. But never try to find a solution that if they are angry, if they are throwing tantrums, and we will also get angry. Never. Okay. And the last, but not the least, it's when we are talking about the emotional intelligence, don't think about that it's only verbally that a child will be able to express. There are different ways in which they express their emotion. They are exercising, they are dancing, they are singing. If I'm happy and I'm doing clapping hands, that is also a way of expressing my emotions through drawing, writing, role play. So depending on the interest of your child, give them the opportunity to express their emotion through these ways. And this today's session, we have discussed what is emotional intelligence, what is benefit, how brain is controlling and we are influencing the development, how to develop the child's emotional intelligence. What will I do is that I will take question and answers from the chat section. Just give me a while to check how to check that. And parents, please see here, there is a mail ID written on my slide, parent.support@clayschools.com. So this is our parent helpline that we have. It's a support program from Clay. It doesn't have any extra cost and we maintain strict confidentiality about identity of parents. So parent, any day you feel like talking and you feel like expressing and you want some solution, you want some support for in your parenting journey, please write to us. We have experts, we have child development experts who will get back to you, who will help you. So please note down this email ID. Meanwhile, I will go to the chat section and I will see the questions here. Okay. I'm just checking. Dhananjay has written, I'm not able to ask question. I hope you have written. Else, you can write Dhananjay in this mail ID. I hope I was audible because I'm finding that some people are not able to listen to it. Madhuka has written, my daughter sometimes starts scratching herself or pulling her hair to show her anger. If something is not to her liking, what should I tell her? So again, here also, Madhuka, it's the same thing that is happening, that your daughter is not able to express the emotion and this is the way she's able to, she's taking out her emotion. So the all the steps that we spoke in the today's session is going to help you. But one thing I will tell you is that, you know, when your child is scratching, your child is pulling her hair, I think that is the time when you calm your child, distract your child, hug her, love her. She should feel that my mom is listening to me. And then when child is, when your daughter is calm and is in good mood, that is the time you should talk to her. We have not mentioned that child's age, but I think when you will help your child develop more of emotion vocabulary, more of expressing their anger in the proper way, you will be able to help. So there are simple, if your child is very young, you know, sometimes they like to do for the anger management, we say, okay, take deep breath or count 1 to 10 if they know to count. Or if you have bubbles at home, say, okay, you blow your bubble. The whole idea is for a child to understand, yeah, something is making me uncomfortable, not happy. I am angry, but scratching and pulling my hair is not going to help. So even some simple stories you can actually create, telling your child that, you know, this girl, whenever she used to be very angry, she used to go and blow bubbles. You want to do that? So it's about helping your child express the emotion, identify, and like I said, also start speaking to your child more about your emotions. What you do when you are angry? How to channelize that energy? Because your mama is also feeling that. Your daddy also feels angry, right? We all get angry, but what do we do? That is something that you have to. So I hope I have answered your question, but still if you have this query, you can write to us on this parent support, giving the more details. For example, you can give one or two examples of what happens or what is the trigger. You try to identify what are the triggers and then work on it. For example, it might be that my child is getting anxious about something, or there is something specific that if you take from your child, the child gets angry. So you will have to understand what is the trigger and then work on it. If you have further query, you're most welcome to write the query on this thing. My daughter, sometime I found this. Then the next question is with Namrata, how to deal with or find out emotions getting developed when both parents are not around? For example, with parents or at the daycare. Okay, so I think when we are talking about the time that we spend with our children, the quality time is going to be very important. So for example, if your child is going to a daycare, when you are taking your child back home, right? Not to talk about your day. But when I'm talking about your day, doesn't mean directly go and ask what happened in the center, what happened in the school. Believe me, 90% of the children, they don't tell what happened. Yeah. So you can start with your emotion. You can tell, how was your day? I'm so tired today. I had so much work. What did you do today? You dance? Did you sing? So you'll have to build up that conversation. Second is, I understand that we are not around most of the time, but there are weekends. So weekends also, there's a good opportunity for you to talk about the emotions. If you are having a routine of a bedtime, at least for 10-15 minutes, it's not matter of how much time you are spending, but like I said, attentively listening to your child and making the child that 15 minutes is not going to be compromised. It's only your child. Yeah. Missed mentioning that she is 4-year-old. Yeah. How to deal with your emotion. Other than the daycare and child care taking, what else Clay is doing to develop the intelligence? Develop. Or child care taking. Okay. Lovely question, Diksha, about what Clay is doing to develop the intelligence of the children. So there are lots of stuff that we are doing, but I'll just give you a basics. That our understanding comes from understanding the milestones of children, right? So you must be aware that at Clay, we have children coming from the 6 months to 10-year-old child. The first thing is that we understand the milestone, the expectation, and the development that is happening. For example, I was talking in my today's webinar that, you know, in the primary year, when we are talking about the development, there is a cognitive development that is happening, that is the socio-emotional development that is happening, emotional development is happening. So when we understand the development of a child, we understand what are the milestones that the child is achieving. And curriculum is also designed in such a way that there is a holistic development of the child. If you have not been to CLAY, I will request you, maybe even you can come to our center, meet other curriculum team members, and we have got wonderful curriculum. The whole idea is about, you know, it's we don't compartmentalize and say the learning is happening only in the classroom. There is learning everywhere and the development is happening all across, right? How do we stimulate and how do we give the environment that our child needs? We were talking about the emotional security, right? So if a child is coming at CLAY, our teachers, our caregivers, they all are trained not only to take care of the learning part, they are also taking care of the emotional requirement of a child, because that is as important as the other aspects. So there are lots of stuff that we are doing, but if you would like to know more, you can definitely send us a mail. And I would really urge you to come once and check. Are there any books which I can read to my child to improve my child's emotional intelligence? So Diksha, like I said, there are definitely more books if you will search on the net, like with the keyword saying that emotional intelligence book or emotion books for children, you will get it. But like I said, it's not about the book. Any kind of storybook that your child likes to read, add emotions to it. For example, my son was very fond of animals. So I used to make all the stories which had animals and the emotions of animals, because that was the way he was able to relate to it. So you can read any book and add emotions for it. Simple ways. What do you think this child is thinking? Or maybe, you know, you can play, do some games where you show some pictures and say, what do you think the child is feeling? I think the child is sad. No, mama. See, the child, the person is happy. Right? So to develop the emotional intelligence, there are books definitely. But I'll urge you that whatever you have, because the interest area of the children also vary. There will be children who will be, you know, musically inclined. They have musical intelligence. Can I do some science, songs and rhymes? Right? He's 11 months old. So this is lovely period, Kameshwari, for your 11-month-old child. Like I was speaking about the infant, it's more on the time that you spend with your child by singing, by reading, and making the child feel special. And also maintain a routine. Maintain a routine will help your child feel more safe and secure. Till what age or what stage of a child's today session is more relevant? Thomas, like I discussed about the emotional development, definitely I will say that for the first 10 years, definitely it's important. But when we are talking about the relevance, I feel for even for a teenage parent, like I have a 12-year-old child and he will be very soon going to be in the teen. I can understand that there are lots of stuff that is a takeaway for me as well. I will say for teenagers also, it will be useful. Thank you, Rashmi, for saying this is excellent and useful. My husband always wants my 3-year-old to behave responsibly. He can never see us showing tantrum. What I can do, he in fact tells me that in all because of me. Okay, so I understand, and I think this is not the first time I'm hearing this question. There are lots of time when we as an adult, we start expecting our child to behave like us. You know, I think there we have to talk to adults also to set the expectation. That are you expecting a 3-year-old child to behave like an adult? You know, when we talk about tantrums and we say the child is throwing tantrum, that is a stage of a development. They will do it. We as an adult have to understand. What I will suggest you, first definitely talk to your husband also. At the same time, help your child. The age group of the 3 is something which is very critical, where you can actually help your child build up the emotional intelligence. If your child is speaking properly and fluently, there are lots of emotion words that you can do with your child. Also, you can do simple role play with your child. So, for example, if there is something specific that is always triggering, where your husband is pointing out that why is your child throwing tantrums, you can do some reverse role play. So, you become the child and your child is the mama or daddy, right? And then you start crying, yelling, shouting the way they are doing. And now ask how they are feeling, right? So, there are different ways definitely you can work with your child. At the same time, setting up the right expectation with the adults. How to control kids when they are going to wrong places to play, which we as a parent know that it is not safe. When we stop our three-year-old, she gets too frustrated and result in slapping everyone around. So I think, again, we are going back to the same thing where the child is not able to express her emotion appropriately and slapping her around, the people around. Second thing is like when you are saying that the place is not safe, I think you will have to figure out a way to speak to your child in a simple way. What do you mean by being unsafe? For example, nowadays, you have seen that because of the corona stuff, we are expecting our children to be at home. If the child is not understanding, you would have found lots of lovely storybooks and the videos are available which make a child understand that why it's not safe, why should we stay at home. So I think you find out the way in which your three-year-old daughter will be able to connect, but don't think that it's just by saying that don't do it or don't go, they will listen. It doesn't happen. Nowadays, children are very logical and they actually expect us that we should be very much specific and we should tell why it's happening. So now that our time is getting over, I will request all of you to share your queries on parent.support@clayschools.com. Also mention the age group of your child. Okay, thanks. I just hope that this session was useful. Anything, any feedback, any suggestion you have, please write to us parents. Thanks a lot.